Very briefly, for those of you not familiar, and of course the practitioners within the SDN arena will be who work for us, you will be aware, I hope, that children and families during the process of assessment can formally request budgets to cover all or some of education healthcare plans. Now, colleagues in social care are currently working on this, and they, by virtue of the nature of their services, are more used to personalised budgets. Health are now working with us closely on what the implications for health might be in terms of family requesting budgets for them to support their own health needs in some areas. And we, of course, in education are working on the education element. There are quite detailed regulations around these personal budgets, which you can find on the website. But the amount of money that may well be requested by a family to support elements within an education and healthcare plan has to be considered by the local authority. It's not an automatic sign-off and we hand over budgets. For example, if a youngster or a family is interested in a particular service, special service that's already provided, let's say, by a special school, it may well be that the local authority wouldn't agree to give a budget for that service to a family, because we still retain the responsibility for the efficient use of our resources, which is absolved that responsibility. So this is a piece of work that we will be doing in the coming weeks. And in terms of managing personal budgets, it can be done in different ways. Family can choose to take a personal budget as a direct payment and manage it themselves, or they may ask a third party or another service to deliver it for them, or they can ask local authority to deliver a service, or it can be a combination of all of those. So this is these are some of the practical issues that we'll be looking at in the coming weeks, and clearly we'll be coming back to the board from time to time to let you know how that's being developed, what the financial implications are, and what the consequences of that will be. At the moment, we've got a trial, for example, with one family, where although the education of their family aren't here until the 1st of September, this is around a youngster at secondary age who, for all sorts of social and medical reasons, for example, won't be in the medical stuff there, actually, in our bedroom. Chairman will be familiar, or probably familiar with this particular case. So a request has come through, for example, for some IT access in the bedroom to help this youngster access his education entitlement. So, in effect, we've more or less agreed that with the family, so it's really a question of having a discussion with the family as to how best to provide, if you like, that support for the youngster. Now, we haven't resolved it completely yet, because certainly for my part, we need to have a very fixed understanding about the route the money will take, the funding will take, who's responsible for what, the monitoring of it, the accountability. I just mentioned the regulations, and an awful lot of the regulations about this. So that's to give you a flavour of some of the interesting work ahead of us and some of the challenges. Schools too, by the way, could well be approached by families quite separately in the process of education and healthcare assessments. Request may go to schools for elements of support that you give to a family, and they say, well, actually, we don't really, the support that the school currently gives to us isn't effective. Would you consider giving us a budget to buy additional support? Of course, it's up to the schools to decide that for themselves. So there are all sorts of different angles in relation to the ongoing development of personal budgets. The other areas I'll just briefly touch on, in relation to current statements of special educational needs, we as a local authority have got 3 years to convert the existing statements into statements transferred to education and health care plans, which may not result in additional assessments being made that weren't made in the same international education. Well, that's what we're doing, and we will publish those arrangements. Very briefly, we will be in a position to publish the local authorities' local offer by the 1st of September this year. And again, it's accepted. It will take anything up to 18 months, 2 years to really refine what that local offer would be. And that includes, of course, all of our partners who have to publish what the independent sector may provide, either within Wirral or in our neighbouring authorities, including the health element and social care as well. So there's much work to be done on that. And then, just briefly to mention the education and healthcare plans themselves, signed up, they've been co-produced by parents and crucial, of course, in schools by the same codes. And we've got two full-day training events next week, and that's an ongoing conversation with the schools about the use of the plans and the pathways, in other words, how the plans have got to be used and the timelines. And the timelines, of course, are framed up in the code of practice, which was published a few years ago. Gives us a responsibility from 0 to 25 years later, a significant new and different responsibility that will have an impact on every local authority's, if you like, arrangements for supporting, for example, children with disabilities and young people, young adults with disabilities. And we are currently in discussion, Julia, our colleagues, myself and others, talking about what that service might begin to look like in the future, because we've got to shape the way we work and change the way we think. And I'll just end up by saying, and I should have referenced in relation to personal budgets at the beginning, personal budgets cannot be agreed unless the budget money is framed very specifically about the outcome for children. So historically in the past, we might have given money or agreed funding for something that now we think is slightly woolly in terms of service, which is a good idea and might be good for the child. It has to be very, very specific in terms of what it will achieve for an individual child. And that's very much the focus of how we're moving now into the future in terms of, crucially, how we commission specialist provision in the future. And that's an ongoing discussion that we obviously need and will have with the schools and all of our partners. That's it, Chair.
Thanks, Phil, for those answers. I was thinking about the future now. So, say something, of course.
It's really interesting looking at the special educational needs SEND, response to children with disabilities, in the context of a whole suite of new measures that have been introduced through the Children and Families Act 2014, which have been implemented now. And I think the latest suite of measures we've implemented are these reforms which Phil has just talked about. But there's a thread running through the measures which relate to children going through legal processes. The thread running through that is speeding up the time scale so that children in care proceedings aren't delayed in those proceedings. We focus on outcomes and how the judiciary and social workers do whatever they need to do as timely and speedily as possible to get the best outcomes for children. There's an emphasis in the whole suite of measures around adoption. You may have heard of the adoption scorecard, the adoption is receiving a lot of national focus from the BND in terms of giving the doctors a bit more power and personal rigidity in terms of what post-adoption support may provide, but also speeding up the timescales and making the court progress. suppose Bill is describing is very much about putting children and families at the heart, making sure that everything that we do is needs-led. It locks parts in a much more public way by talking about education, health and care plans, rather than just a statement, it's a terminology. It very much kind of mobilises the approach. At the heart of this is very much meeting children's needs, but everyone is required to think to what end. So what outcomes are we trying to achieve? And interestingly, the legislation, which I found really helpful, the kind of vision and aspirations that the government sets for children with disabilities and special education needs are exactly the same as for children who do not have special education needs or disabilities. So the outcomes are very much the children flourish, that they achieve their full potential, and it's within that context that these reports and individual measures need to be implemented. So if you think there's much more greater flexibility, much greater choice, much greater focus on what's the end result, and how partners we work together to achieve that. So it's really important that we retain that spirit of this new legislation as we move forward. I think it's quite exciting.
School funding reform proposal 2015-16.
there are a number of things that affect actually the distance in the meeting and set out there and whether this area should be considered. If it should, what should that, what form should that take? What are the alternatives we could consider? And the one that I wanted to just briefly talk about is the final level, which is really possible to be out of the preschool year. What's that? What we talked about in these meetings was that since 2011, the number of preschool meetings in schools has reduced from about over 10,000, and that's just over 8,000 over a fairly short period of time. As a result of that, because within the form of the allocated percentage of the total resources to the education, it means that as the number of youth is reduced, the amount of the shine that we allocate for three school years increases. And it would be possible to say that in the future that there should be a cap that therefore we reach a ceiling and the amount of people just increase beyond that. So I suppose